Hello friends, I am Dr. Sameer Pilankar, orthopedic surgeon at Cooper Hospital and HBT Medical College. Today we'll be discussing about shoulder arthroscopy, the anatomy, the instability part, then the slab tears and rotator cuff. The common topics which we encounter day in and day out. And for this, I have a great panel of consultants with me, Dr. Amit Doshi, who is a lecturer at Cooper Hospital. Then Dr. Abhishek Nerurkar, who is at Hinduja and at Nanavati. And that will be followed by Dr. Kaustu, who will be speaking on rotator cuff. And myself, I will be speaking on the easiest part, that is the instability. And before we start, let me thank Biotech for arranging this great webinar. And also a big thanks to the delegates who have logged in spite of the deluge of webinars which are there in the lockdown. We have been flooded with webinars, but I promise you that this particular webinar will be a different webinar. It is, apart from the great panelists, it will be crisp and to the point and very practical. So, without further ado, let me give the mic to Dr. Amit Joshi, who is a budding arthroscopist and doing great work at Cooper and Trauma Hospital. So he'll be speaking on anatomy, especially arthroscopic anatomy of the shoulder. So Dr. Amit, are you ready?
Yes, sir. Absolutely. I'll share my screen.
Your screen and start with the talk. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for the wonderful introduction. Is it visible?
Yes, yes. We can see the screen.
Yeah.
A very good evening, everyone. A very good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Amit Joshi, sports and trauma surgeon from Mumbai, Balasaheb Thackeray Trauma Hospital. I would like to thank Dr. Sameer Pilankar, sir, and Biotech for giving me this opportunity. The topic of my presentation is arthroscopic anatomy of the shoulder. In this presentation, we'll be discussing about the important anatomical structures of the shoulder, their normal variants, their pathological variants, followed by the surface anatomy of the shoulder and steps in the diagnostic arthroscopy to identify these anatomical structures. The shoulder is stabilized through a static mechanism and the dynamic mechanism. The static mechanism includes bony configurations of glenoid and the humerus, the glenoid labrum, the joint capsule, the glenohumeral ligaments, and the dynamic mechanism involves the rotator cuff muscles, the long head of the biceps, and the deltoid muscle, as shown in the diagram on the right side. So coming on to the bony configurations of the glenoid and the humerus, there is a large mismatch between the glenoid fossa and the humeral head. The glenoid fossa is around 6 to 7 square centimeters, while the humeral head is around 20 to 24 square centimeters. According to the Ann Busker and Pulse, the shape of the glenoid is either teardrop, also known as pear shape, or an oval shape, where the cranial and the caudal diameters are similar. The functional relevance of such shapes is not fully understood yet. In the center of the glenoid, there is a physiological thinning of the cartilage known as the bare area, but it should not be confused with the cartilage defect. In contrast, the humeral head is thickest in the center. Similar to the glenoid bare area, there is a humeral bare area which lies posterolaterally adjacent to the rotator cuff insertion. The glenoid version and humeral version also influence in the glenohumeral stability. The humeral inclination is about 130 to 150 degrees and it is retroverted at about 30 to 45 degrees. The glenoid retroversion is around 2 to 5 degrees. You can see the bare areas of the glenoid in figure A and the humerus posterolateral bare area in the smaller figure on the right corner. Coming on to the pathological anatomy, there is the bony Bankart lesion, which is the anteroinferior bone loss of the glenoid, the inverted pear-shaped glenoid, the Hill-Sack lesion, which is the posterolateral defect on the humerus, and the increased glenoid version. All these pathological factors lead to instability in the shoulder. On the right side, right uppermost corner, you can see the bony Bankart's lesion. And they can also observe the asterisk marked right corner picture showing the Hill-Sachs lesion. The labrum is partly collagenous and partly cartilaginous inserted into the scapular neck. It covers the glenoid cavity and forms a functional unit with the capsule, the long head of the biceps, the long head of the triceps, along with the glenohumeral ligaments. So the labrum is divided into six sectors, the superior sector, the anterosuperior sector, the anterior sector, the inferior, posterior superior sector, which gives attachment to the glenohumeral ligaments as well as the bicep tendons along with capsular attachments. So the normally the glenoid labrum increases in the bony contact size and the joint congruity. It increases the stress distribution and the stability of the joint. It acts as a tension break. The blood supply to the glenoid labrum is from the suprascapular artery, the anterior humeral circumflex artery, the posterior humeral circumflex artery, and it is minimal in the superior and the anterosuperior parts, leading to a limited regenerative potential in those areas. The glenoid labrum often exists normally as a small recess or a meniscus-like shape. So it should not be confused with some defect, and we should not go ahead and try to repair such. So there can also be a sublabral hole in 12 to 18.5% of the population, as shown in the figure A, which is also defined as the complete separation of the glenoid from the labrum. It can also show itself as a buffered complex, which is in which the anterosuperior labrum is absent and is replaced by the middle glenohumeral ligament. This can be mistaken for the separation of the anterior labrum. And you can also observe that the superior glenohumeral ligament is absent, as well as the inferior glenohumeral ligament is well developed. So coming on to the pathologic anatomy, I'll just describe it in brief. Rest will be taken care of by the rest of the faculty. So in this, it is about slap lesions. As you can see, the figure A shows that there is a small labral recess marked with an asterisk, but there is no mobility when it is probed with a hook. In figure B, you can see there is a degenerative fraying of the bicep anchor, also known as a type 1 slap lesion. In figure C, you can see that the slap lesion with instability of the bicep anchor while fully exposing the glenoid marked with an arrow. And in type 4 slap lesions, where the rupture extends into the long head of the bicep tendon and combines with a bucket handle tear of the labrum posteriorly. So coming on to the Bankart lesion and ALPSA lesions, the Bankart lesion on the left shows a labral detachment inferior to the equator, most likely causes of instability, whereas ALPSA lesions also known as anterior labroligamentous periosteal sleeve avulsions, where the labrum is torn and the IGHL is scarred to the medial glenoid neck, usually it is seen in cases of multiple dislocations as seen in figure. In cases of posterosuperior impingements, this is the typical arthroscopic picture where you can see the hypervascularity of the labrum marked with an asterisk and small cartilaginous defects at the supraspinatus insertion marked with a small arrow. Articular side fraying of the supraspinatus tendon is marked with a large arrow as seen in this picture. Coming on to the capsule and the glenohumeral ligaments, the capsule is a complex system of circularly and radially arranged collagen fibers. It is strengthened by the coracohumeral ligaments, the SGHL, MGHL, IGHL, and circumferentially inserting into the rotator cuff tendons. The rotator interval is the space between the supraspinatus and the subscapularis. Following is the image of a rotator interval, where A denotes the coracohumeral ligament, which radiates laterally from the coracoid process and inserts into the greater and the lesser tuberosities. The B marks the long head of biceps tendon. C marks the superior glenohumeral ligament. D is the tendinous slip. E is the transverse humeral ligament encasing the long head of biceps tendon. And F is the subscapularis muscle. So coming on to the superior glenohumeral ligament, it begins from the supraglenoid tubercle and runs along the coracohumeral ligament to form the main construct of a bicep pulley system. It also helps in the posterior and the inferior instability. Coming on to middle glenohumeral ligament and subscapularis, the middle glenohumeral ligament radiates from the supraglenoid tubercle and ends on the tuberosities. It prevents the shoulder from anterior dislocation. The subscapularis muscle serves as an anatomical landmark and forms the inferior border of the rotator interval. It originates from the subscapular fossa and ends on the lesser tuberosities. Inferior glenohumeral ligament. The inferior glenohumeral ligament consists of anterior band and the posterior band, which it prevents the shoulder from anterior dislocation. It prevents the shoulder from inferior dislocation. Both the parts stabilize the shoulder in variable abduction and external rotation. Hence, this complex is also known as a hammock configuration. So anatomic variance in case of glenohumeral ligaments is when in type 1, all the glenohumeral ligaments can be identified separately. When the inferior as well as the middle glenohumeral ligaments are fused, or in the third type where the middle glenohumeral ligament has a strong cord-like shape. In fourth one, all the ligaments are missing completely. These are some of the anatomic variations. Pathological anatomy in case of glenohumeral ligaments is when there is a bident rotator cuff interval, when there is an HAGL lesion, or if there is a drive-through sign. What is a bident rotator cuff interval? It means that the coracohumeral ligament and the superior glenohumeral ligaments are not adequately torsioned in external rotation and the capsule is bulging out. Hence, it leads to anterior, inferior, and posterior dislocation. In cases of HAGL lesions, which are also known as humeral avulsions of glenohumeral ligaments, which is rare, but it can be a cause of an unstable shoulder. What is a drive-through sign? A drive-through sign is when the capsule is so lax that the scope passes through the glenohumeral ligaments without any resistance. Falling in is an example of an HAGL lesion where the image on the left is of a normal anatomy where the middle glenohumeral ligament is passing over the subscapularis muscle at an angle of 45 degrees while the arrows are marking the anterior border of the inferior glenohumeral ligament. HH is the humeral head and L is the labrum. On the right side, it shows the image of a humerus avulsion of glenohumeral ligament where the capsule is marked with an arrow. It is separated completely and the asterisk is showing the underlying exposed muscles. Coming on to the long head of biceps, it originates from the supraglenoid tubercle as well as the superior labrum and extends distally into the bicipital groove along the proximal humerus. It is stabilized in the groove by the transverse humeral ligament. It also helps in the stabilization of the glenohumeral ligament in abducted and externally rotated position. It inserts into the both supraglenoid tubercle and the glenoid labrum. It is guided into the tubercular circles by a pulley sling system, which is surrounded by the SGHL at the bottom and the medial wall along with the subscapularis. Coracohumeral ligament forms the roof and the lateral wall along with the supraspinatus. The following is a small picture depicting the attachment of the bicep to the supraglenoid tubercle, marked with an asterisk. Then coming on to the pathological anatomy, slap lesions have already been described earlier. There can be lesions of the pulley sling, and then there can be a lipstick sign, which is the erythema of the bicep tendon in the intertubercular sulcus, leading to retraction of the tendon and showing signs of bicep tendonitis. This following is a small example of pulley sling lesions. On the left side, the image is showing the long head of bicep tendon, which is marked with an asterisk. It is showing that the pulley sling system is of the superior glenohumeral ligament is working absolutely fine, which is marked with an arrow. On the right side, you can see through with the arrow, there is a lesion of the pulley sling. There is fraying of the superior glenohumeral ligament, as well as the long head of bicep tendon has been pushed medially. So this was what happens in case of pulley sling lesions. Then rotator cuff muscles, four muscles, subscapularis, supraspinatus, infraspinatus, and teres minor. They centralize the head into the humeral head and add to the stability. Patient usually age more than 40 years, have rotator cuff tears, and they end with instability of the shoulder. So a small outline on the arthroscopy, how do you delineate a patient? A patient will be on the traction table in 70 degrees of abduction and 15 degrees of forward flexion. You palpate the supraclavicular fossa and it is bounded anteriorly by the clavicle, posteriorly by the scapular spine and laterally by the acromion. You trace the acromion as well as the coracoid borders. They are all reference lines. It should be palpated with the fingers. And you should always make sure that you are palpating the inferior margins of such bones. Place your thumb in the supraclavicular notch and use the index finger to outline the lateral border of the acromion also. So after that, outline the clavicle, followed by outline the scapular spine, then identify the AC joint. And starting from the posterior border of the AC joint, you have to drop a perpendicular towards the acromion lateral border, and it should extend at least 5 centimeters more into the distal limb. This divides the acromion into anterior 2/5 and posterior 3/5. The anterior acromion 2/5 will contain the bicep tendon and the rotator cuff interval, while the posterior acromion will contain the posterior bursal girdle. Two major portal placements in cases of diagnostic arthroscopy is the posterior medullary portal and the anterior medullary portal. The posterior medullary portal is placed 2 to 3 centimeters inferior and 1 to 2 centimeters medial from the posterior lateral corner of the acromion, while the anterior mid glenoid portal has to be established from an inside out technique where the scope is passed through the posterior portal between the biceps and the subscapularis and finally piercing the capsule. It should be around 3 centimeters inferior and 2 centimeters medial to the anterior edge of the acromion. We usually follow a 15-point anatomical review to review all the structures around the shoulder. So 10 structures are reviewed through the posterior mid-glenoid portal, and around 5 structures are reviewed from the anterior mid-glenoid portal. Through the posterior mid-glenoid portal, going in a anti-clockwise fashion, we start from the bicep tendon and superior labrum. Tracing down, we go towards the posterior labrum and posterior capsule recess, followed by inferior axillary recess and inferior capsular insertion to the humeral head, the inferior labrum, and the glenoid articular surface, the supraspinatus tendon and the rotator cuff, the posterior rotator cuff insertion and the bare area of humeral head, the articular surface of the humeral head, the anterior superior labrum, the superior and middle glenohumeral ligaments and subscapular tendon, the anterior inferior labrum and the anterior inferior ligament. Then we go on to the anterior portal. From there, we again go in this fashion, where we start from the posterior glenoid labrum and capsule insertion into the humeral head, followed by posterior rotator cuff, including infraspinatus and the supraspinatus tendon, the anterior glenoid labrum and the inferior glenohumeral ligament attachment to the humeral head, the subscapularis tendon and recess and the middle glenohumeral ligament and attachment to the labrum, the anterior surface of the humeral head, with the subscapularis attachment and the bicep tendon's passage through the rotator interval. So finally, concluding my talk, saying the shoulder stability is maintained by a complex interplay between the dynamic and the static stabilizers. Detailed knowledge of the anatomical structures, including the normal variation and the functional relevance, is a prerequisite for the adequate diagnosis and therapy. Shoulder allows not only detailed visualization, but also a dynamic examination of all the relevant and anatomical structures. Following are my references. Thank you so much.
Yeah, very nice, Amit.
Thank you, sir. I'll just stop sharing my slides, sir. Thank you, sir.
Amit, that was a very comprehensive and good presentation. You covered almost everything. Now, we'll move on to Dr. Abhishek. We will be speaking on slab tests.
Thank you, Samir sir, for inviting me. Thank you, Biotech, for giving me this opportunity. Let me just... Can you see me?
Yes, good.
Okay. So, it was a nice description of anatomy by Dr. Amit Joshi. And I'm going to talk today about slab tests. Mainly, I'll concentrate on overview of slab and how do you plan your management in cases of slab tests. So, what is a slab lesion or a slab tear? Basically, slab is an acronym for superior labral tear from anterior to posterior. So as you know, the glenoid labrum, the superiorly is a fibrocartilaginous rim and attached to the margin of the glenoid. And any kind of injury to this margin, to the labrum, as well as the biceps anchor there, is termed as a slap tear. So the anatomy has been described already, but there are certain variations that you should take care of, or you should know when you are dealing with the slap lesions. The superior labrum is usually meniscoid or triangular, and it has a sublabral recess, which should not be mistaken for a tear. The biceps origin is also variable. It can vary from 12 o'clock, 11 o'clock to 1 o'clock position. And the superior labrum is mobile as compared to the rest of the labrum. And there is variable attachment in the anterior superior quadrant. So as compared to how the anterior inferior or the posterior labrum is, which is tightly adherent to the glenoid rim, superior labrum may have some normal mobility. The supra, the SGHL and MGHL are also attached at the complex where this labrum and the slap is attached. The SGHL predominantly arises from the supraglenoid tubercle, and some fibers do arise from the biceps superior labral origin, whereas the MGHL is, the attachment is variable. And if you see this figure on the top, usually it passes around 45 degrees to 90 degrees perpendicular at an angle. It crosses the subscap, and that is how you identify it. So slap tears history, if you see, the tears have been described first by Andrews in 1985 for overhead athletes. And they used to perform debridement for these tears, which was considered to be an effective treatment at that particular point of time. In 1990, this particular term, the slap tear or slap lesion, was coined by Snyder when he was describing the labral injuries surrounding the biceps origin. So a lot of times you'll come to, you know, there'll be surgeons talking about biceps being a vestigial organ, and the only thing that biceps gives is pain and nothing else. And that is why there is a school of thought that you should sacrifice the biceps. But to decide whether there is any role to preserve the long head of biceps and its attachment to the superior labrum, we should know the biomechanics. Basically, biceps contributes to the increase in stability of the translational and rotational movements. If you see, there are two attachments of biceps. One that is attached to the coraco along, this is a conjoint tendon. When there is a biceps contracture, it will push the head up. And this particular thing is counteracted by the long head of biceps. So it is basically helping to centralize the head into the glenoid socket. In elbow flexion and supination, when you release the LHB or the long head of biceps, there is proximal humeral migration by 15.5%, which is quite significant. And experimentally created type 2 lesions also increase the anterior translation at 30 degrees and 60 degrees. These are some of the papers from JBJS and American Journal of Sports Medicine, which shows that biceps does have, the long head of biceps does have some importance. So when do you get slap tear? So mainly it can be divided into acute traumatic lesions, and it can be because of repetitive trauma or sports. So acute injury can happen in a motor vehicle accident, a fall on outstretched hand, forceful pulling of the arm, such as when you're trying to catch a heavy object, especially when you're doing it as overhead activity, rapid or forceful movement of the arm, again, in overhead activities can lead to slap tears. And it is sometimes a component of the shoulder dislocation. So if you have a shoulder dislocation, don't prefix your mind looking at only Bankards and Hillsex. There may be an associated slap tear also. So what are the repetitive things that lead to slap tear? Mainly it is in overhead sports, such as throwing athletes or weightlifters. So sports like baseballs, in which the pitching is important, and in cricket, in throwing from the from long distances, also in badminton and tennis, and it is commonly seen in weightlifters. There is a degenerative variant of slap, which also happens between 30 to 40 years of age, and usually it is a grade 1 tear, which shows fraying of the superior labrum, and it is a normal process or a normal variant of aging. So what does the patient present with? Usually a patient is going to come to you with pain somewhere deep within the shoulder or at the back of the shoulder. Patient may have increase in pain. So if you have a intellectual patient, he may actually tell you that I get pain in certain specific positions or while doing certain specific activities. They may also present to you with catching, popping or clicking kind of sensations. And most commonly it is in overhead activities. So if you're trying to remove some weight from your storage or something from higher up, or if you are trying to put your back onto a rack, these are the certain situations where you'll get pain in slap lesions, and it's often confused with impingement syndromes also. So in athletes, pain happens while throwing or pitching. I'm talking about pitching because it is the reason for which it was described initially. There is a decrease in the strength of the shoulder, so power may be reduced. There is decrease in velocity of throwing. Also, there will be a reduction in the range of movement, especially internal rotation. And patients may complain of having a dead arm during throwing. So, when you see how to diagnose slap tear, certainly there are no specific investigations. I mean, if you see all the investigations that are the other tests that have been listed, none of them are very sensitive and specific. But you should always do this O'Brien's test. And how do you exactly do it? You basically have to put your arm in 90 degrees of flexion, then take it into 10 to 20 degrees of adduction, and then you pronate. So once you pronate the arm, you have to tell the patient to have forward elevation under, it's a resisted movement, and this will lead to pain on the anterior aspect of the shoulder. You also have to make sure that you supinate the forearm and repeat the same test. And if there is relief of pain, this is considered to be a positive O'Brien's test. There are certain other tests for biceps, mainly the Groot test, speed test, and Yergason test. Groot test is basically the patient is directly pointing at the anterior, biceps tendon. Speed test is you do resisted forward elevation with arm in supination. And Yergason test is in which patient is trying to internally rotate with the elbow in 90 degrees flexion, again, which is a resistant movement. So what are the slap lesions? I'm going to describe the slap lesions, and I'll show you the arthroscopic picture of each type. So it is divided into four types. And the first type is just fraying, which is usually seen in degenerative conditions. Second type is the most common type, and there is a detachment of the superior labrum and biceps from the glenoid rim. The third type is a bucket handle tear of the labrum, and the fourth or the least common type is an intrasubstance tear of the biceps tendon along with the bucket handle tear of the superior labrum. So this is how it is going to look when you arthroscopically. The type 1 is usually just a fraying of the superior labrum. Around 20 to 25% of the cases will show this type 1 tear. And they are a part of the degenerative process and more commonly in the middle-aged people. Type 2 are by far the most common. You can see here there is a complete detachment of the labrum along with the biceps tendon. The SGHL and MGHL may be detached as well. So evaluation of their instability is also important. Type 3 lesions are again 9 to 10%. And as you see a bucket handle tear in your meniscus, this is something similar to that. You can see that the labrum is flipped inside the joint. And it just looks like a bucket handle tear of the meniscus. Okay, but usually it is the biceps labrum. The superior labrum and biceps is usually attached to the supraglenoid tubercle. Type 4 are the tears in which the tear actually extends into the biceps tendon. So these are the type 4. There are basically four types. There have been classifications also, but I think for management purposes, these four types are good enough to take a decision about what you're going to do. So X-rays are usually normal unless they are associated with another pathology. And what we need to see is an MRI. MRI is quite sensitive. for slab tear, if you see on the left side, it's a normal labrum, and you can see the continuity with the superior glenoid. Whereas on the right side, there is a fluid passing between the labrum or the superior labrum and the glenoid rim. So this is an MRI arthrogram. So normal MRI is around 65 to 70% specific. With addition of a sensitive and with addition of arthrogram, you can detect up to 95% of the slab lesions. So how do you treat once you know that there's a slab tear? What should be your approach for treatment? The type 1 slab is pretty straightforward. The management has to be conservative, physiotherapy, activity modification, and anti-inflammatory medications. So you have to explain the patient to avoid throwing, do all the weight-related activities like push-ups and climbings. And obviously, you have to tell them to reduce the overhead activities. Type 2 is the most common tear and by far the most controversial about how you're going to manage these particular tears. Again, it is prudent to give a conservative trial. You give physiotherapy, activity modifications and medications, and you observe the patient how he is improving. Early operative intervention is usually not recommended unless the patient is an overhead athlete or patient requires to need overhead lift to overhead weights, and sometimes in very young patients. Again, there are a lot of options available about what you can do in a type 2 tear. You can just debride, you can do a superior labral repair, biceps sternotomy or biceps sternodesis. And the treatment decision is usually made based on the patient's age, activity level and concomitant pathology. So you have to understand, you have to see the patient as a whole, evaluate globally what are the lifestyle requirements, what is the age, and then you come to a conclusion about what you're going to do with this particular type 2 slab test. So there are a lot of studies, again, they don't come to a conclusion regarding what is exactly to be done for a specific tear. And as the slab repair and bicep stenodesis are both acceptable as an index treatment for isolated slab type 2 slab test. And though biceps slab repair remains the most commonly performed index procedure, stenodesis is an equally good alternative. So another article from Journal of Arthroscopy, they show good results with stenodesis over the slab repair. In general, you can follow this algorithm. If you have a patient with a type 2 tear, you start with non-operative management. Give non-operative management till the patient is not improving or the patient demands surgery. If the patient is above 60 years of age and low activity demand, then you can go ahead with biceps sternotomy. If the patient is middle age and non-overhead athlete, then you can do a biceps sternodesis, which can be again at various levels, intra-articular, suprapectoral, subpectoral. You can take a call on that. And if the patient is young in age and has overhead activities, then you can go for a slab repair. So this is a short video about how you're going to do a slab repair. So always debride the tear first. You look for the tear, clean it with a shaver or RF, whatever you feel like. Once you are in the frayed part, you go inside and clear the rim of all its fibrous attachment. You have to make a good bed for that particular tear to heal. Because if you just repair it without doing these basic steps, then the healing rates will be very low. How you place your anchor is very important. You usually put one or two anchors. And the first tear is usually put in the bicep attachment. So you go, you can start and go between the biceps. And then you lift the labral part, which is uprooted. Then you place an anchor. You can put a normal push-in or screw-in anchor, whichever you prefer. So once the anchor is placed, you are going to take, and usually I use a double loaded anchor. So you can take one bite ahead and one bite behind the biceps tendon. So take a bird beak, see the trajectory of the instruments have to come from top to bottom. It is not similar to how you take the bites for the Bankart lesions. So once you have taken a bite posteriorly, you slide in a knot and fix it. and then you repeat the same thing for the other two threads. So you take in a bite with a bird beak, anterior to the biceps tendon. And pass in a sliding knot. So once you are done with these two knots, then you decide, you probe the labrum again and you see whether it is still detached and assess whether you should put another anchor or not. And as I said, the anatomy of the slab is variable. So you decide where you're going to put the anchor based on where the detachment is. So although you give your best, but the surgical outcomes are not very predictable. There are reports about failure of healing, concomitant biceps tendinitis, stiffening of the joint. There is residual instability and hardware complications. So a lot of complications have been noted. Again, if you see the quality of life for the VAS score, you may have a lot of variation. One thing is very important when you are doing this slap repairs. Most of the time, we see the biceps tendon inside the joint. But you should take an effort to go and look into the bicipital groove. A lot of times the tendon in the bicipital groove may be thickened or may be flattened, or there may be inflammation in the tendon. And if you repair such biceps, then you will not get a good outcome. So if there's a bicipital tendinosis or bicipital damage inside the groove, then it is better to go and fix it in the subpectoral region. And if you have elderly patients, then you can always go for a tenotomy. How do you do tenodesis? I think I'm not going to detail, but one thing is for sure, you take lasso loops or bites inside and securely hold the tendon before you punch it into the glenoid head. And don't cut the tendon before you do all these things, because if you cut the tendon, then it is very difficult to take a hold on the tendon. So you can use the anchor of your choice. And once it is fixed, then you can do the tenotomy part of it. Just a brief about what is subpectoral tenodesis. Nowadays, there is a trend towards increase in fixation of the biceps in the subpectoral area. And if you see the incision is just lateral to the crease and medial to the border of the deltoid. Okay, and you go under the pectoralis major inferior border. That is where you are going to go. Some people do split the pectoralis muscle, or you can just retract it superiorly and then identify the biceps tendon. And then there are various ways in which you can fix it. You can use an interference screw, or you can use a suture anchor. You can also use it to fix it in a transverseous manner. So there are multiple papers that will be favoring a particular kind of treatment. But I think subpectoral tenodesis with either an interference screw or a suture anchor is a good enough technique. So what a patient is allowed to do and what a patient should not do. These are the two things you have to brief them right in the beginning when you start the treatment. Strength training with resistance is very important. Range of movement and rotations have to be maintained. You train the deltoid, front raises, lateral raises up to 90 degrees, and rowing is a preferred mode of exercise. You do a seated rowing, not a bent rowing. Bent rowing is in which you bend forward and then lift the weights. So that is not the good thing to do in slap test. And mobility, usually there is a glenohumeral internal rotation deficit for which you have to do these sleeper stretches to maintain the range of movement. What you should avoid, this is extremely important. Any exercises loading the joint or lifting free weights have to be avoided. Any traction force like pulling on the arm has to be avoided. Jerky movements, and especially in overhead activities, and also underarm throwing has to be avoided. And overhead weights. So you avoid all the overhead activities and jerky activities. Can you see me? So in summary, signs and symptoms of slap are not very conclusive. So you have to actually develop your clinical acumen to understand what is happening inside the shoulder and then treat accordingly. MRI is the most sensitive test for diagnosis. And MRI is the most sensitive test for diagnosis. Treatment of type 1 tear is conservative. It is very straightforward. Type 2, it is a planning dilemma. The results are very controversial, and you have to assess each patient individually to decide what is best for your patient. Adequate conservative trial should always be given before going in for a surgical intervention. Type 3 and type 4 are rare, and they require either tenotomy or tenodesis, or you can also suture them. So you have to evaluate every tear carefully and decide what is best for that particular tear. And although after the best of your efforts, the results or prognosis may be unpredictable. Thank you.
I think covered it.
Yeah.
Yes, Abhishek, I think you have covered a very difficult topic in a very comprehensive and detailed manner.
Thank you.
And it has cleared a few doubts in the delegates about this particular slap pathology. Next, I'll be taking over the mic for instability lecture. So I'll start sharing my screen. Just a quick question while the screen is trying to share.
Yeah.
If you get a slap type 2 lesion when you are scoping for a Bankart, what is your approach to it?
So again, it depends on, as I said, it depends on age and it depends on the activity level. But if the patient is coming with instability and if I'm going to fix the anterior inferior labrum, and if there is a type 2 kind of a slap tear, then it is better to stabilize the slap if the biceps tendon is normal. So you have to look at the biceps tendon. If the biceps tendon is normal inside the groove, then you can certainly go ahead with the slap repair. If you think that the biceps tendon is not normal or there is tenodesis, and because there are a lot of this biceps tendon inside the groove is very pain sensitive, and that it can cause a lot of issues, and then you can do subpectoral tenodesis. But there's one thing that I would like to tell, that if you are planning for a subpectoral tenodesis, you should not waste too much of time in doing scopy, because the shoulder swells up and then doing a subpectoral tenodesis can be a big problem. So if you are thinking in that terms, do a quick scopy, finish off the subpectoral tenodesis, and then go ahead inside and do your scopy again.
Right. And another question, is my screen being shared? Can you see my screen?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. So we'll take the questions at the very end. So I have been introduced to all of you already. I am Dr. Pilankar. I am an arthroscopy arthroplasty surgeon at Cooper and HBT Medical College. And I'll be talking on a very common ailment which we treat day in and day out, that is recurrent dislocation of the shoulder. So I'll start with this quote by Voltaire, who was a great French philosopher. Change is the only constant in life. So life, everything keeps on changing, and unless you adapt to the change, you will be left behind. So that is no more truer than in shoulder surgery. I remember when I started my residency, we used to do open Bankart repair. And most of the patients were not very happy with the results following the surgery. And today in this age, we are doing arthroscopic Bankart repair and even arthroscopic Latarge. So we have come a long way from this open surgery to arthroscopic surgery, which we do today. So shoulder, as you know, is a very unique joint in which it is a very unstable joint, as Dr. Amit has told you. It has traded stability towards for mobility. So what it gains in mobility, it has compromised in its stability. It is commonly shown as a golf ball on a teacup, tea. And the glenoid is very tiny, while the head is quite large compared to the base of the glenoid. So we need additional structures to stabilize it. These are basically the labrum and the muscles which stabilize it. On its own, it is a very unstable joint. Just the bony architecture, if you take of the shoulder, it is a very unstable joint. So the labrum deepens the cavity of the glenoid and the muscles add to the stability. So together, then it becomes a okay sort of stable joint to allow for the movements without dislocation. So you have the bone, which is the glenoid, the labrum, which deepens the cavity, and the ligaments, the glenohumeral ligaments, and there are muscles. So all these together make it a marvel of nature. That is, it is a unstable joint just bordering on instability for giving mobility to the person. So whenever there is a glenoid lesion, that is a Venkat lesion, you get dislocation of the shoulder. So this particular lesion, that is a Venkat lesion, which is the avulsion and tear of the glenoid labrum from the 6 o'clock to almost 3 o'clock position, antero-inferior part, is the essential lesion in all anterior dislocations. Almost 95% of the dislocations will have this particular Venkat lesion. This was discovered fairly recently, that is in 1970s. And immediately after that, the Venkat procedure was devised, which was basically the repair of the Venkat lesion. And for some time, we had fantastic results, and Venkat repair was thought to be the final answer. But as the saying goes, that nothing rubbishes a good result as a follow-up, about 10 to 15% failure was seen in patients with pure Venkat repair. So then the orthopedicians started thinking and analyzing their results, and they found that the bony contours are also important. Not only the Venkat lesion, but also the bony contours are important. So then they found two particular defects, one on the humeral side, which is the heel sacs, and one on the glenoid side. So these defects, when they were present, then the pure Venkat repair was failing. So the humeral defect is in the superolateral part of the humeral head, and this is known as the heel sacs defect. Now again, there are two types of heel sacs defect. One is a non-engaging type, which is a smaller, and one is a larger, wider heel sacs defect, which is the engaging heel sacs. And with this, you have this on-track and off-track type of lesions. So this non-engaging is basically the on-track defect, in which it does not engage into the glenoid edge. So this is on-track. While the off-track is the engaging heel sacs, which is wide. And when the thing dislocates, the shoulder dislocates, this engages into the edge of the glenoid. And basically, this keeps on widening the defects, and you get bone loss both as the glenoid as well as the humeral head. And you get more frequent dislocations with the engaging type of heel sacs. So basically, the engaging heel sacs needs to be addressed with additional procedures apart from the Venkat repair. While a small non-engaging defect, you can leave alone. Again, the glenoid bone defect is also important. As you see here, if there is loss in the glenoid edge, then the head topples off and you get dislocation. So 25% of our dislocators have this. And of this, if there is more than 20% of the glenoid loss, then it is supposed to be significant. And as I said, you need to address the bone loss with a Latarge procedure if there is more than 20%. That is the cutoff bone loss, more than 20%. So basically, if you analyze these cases of shoulder dislocation, you get five broad groups. One is the pure soft tissue dislocators, which are very well managed with Bankart repair. And then you have the heel sacs bony defect, more than 20%, which require a remplissage, and the glenoid bone defect patients who need a latar J. Apart from these three main groups, there's a subgroup of first-time traumatic dislocators, which we need to address in a different manner. And there's a multidirectional instability group, which also you cannot fit into the above four groups, and it has to be dealt with separately. So there are various factors when it comes to the perfect treatment for shoulder dislocation, like the bone loss, then the amount of labral tear, then the age of the patient, occupation. So all these factors, if you add on to the computer and create an algorithm, it becomes a very complicated algorithm, and decision making in fact becomes more complicated. So we are orthopedicians. We always come up with simplified algorithms, and this is my simplified algorithm for treatment of shoulder instability. So basically, there are three main groups. Without bone loss, you treat with arthroscopic Bankart repair. With glenoid bone loss, you directly do a latar J, whether arthroscopic or open. And if there is a significant humeral bone loss, heel sacs, you add a remplissage to the arthroscopic Bankart repair. So that basically simplifies your treatment algorithm. So let's start with the first, that is the commonest Bankart repair for Bankart lesion. So this is the lesion, the Bankart lesion from 3 to 6 antero inferior. And what we do is basically create the portals anterior and posterior, pressure up the edge of the labrum and the bony bed, put in the anchor at 5-5:30, do the shuttling, and tie up the labrum. Usually three anchors minimum are required to get a good Bankart repair. This is my preferred position, though even the beach chair position is good enough if you are comfortable with it. Now, key to success to getting a perfect Bankart repair is to create good correct portals. The antero superior and antero inferior should be well spaced off to avoid crowding of the instruments. Then you have to prepare the lesion with shaver and rasp. And you need a correct on the face anchor placement. It should not be at the edge, but it should be on the face so that you get a increase in the cavity by forming the bumper effect. Do a good capsular shift, and you need to form this at the end of the surgery. You should have this capsulolabral bumper, and this will prevent dislocation. So just to reiterate, two portals anteriorly. One is the antero superior and the antero inferior. It is better that we shift our viewing camera to the antero superior, so that we can see the entire anterior labrum. Or you can do from the posterior also if the labral tear is not that significant. This is the view from the antero superior portal, where we see the entire glenoid as well as the anterior and posterior labrum. So this is the preferred viewing portal while repairing. A short video showing the same Bankart repair. This is the Bankart lesion getting prepared with rasp. as Dr. Abhishek has described in the slab, you need to have a good bed. Otherwise, your repair will fail. You should have good bleeding bed from the bone as well as the labrum, and that will produce good healing of the capsulolabral bumper. While using the shaver, I stop the suction, put the suction off so that you don't. Sometimes the labrum is quite friable and it can just pull the labrum and damage the labrum, and then you have nothing to repair. The anchor is passed at the 5:30 position, either the peak or all suture. I usually avoid titanium anchors in the Mankart repair. Once the anchor is deployed, ensure that the thread is sliding, and then take a good bite at 6 o'clock position, taking the IGHL in the bite, and then the shuttling is done using the antero inferior portal. In this case, I use the posterior as the viewing portal, and the shuttling, both the portals are anterior, antero superior, anterior inferior, for deploying and shuttling. Important thing to note is you need a capsular shift, that is, you need to pull the capsule from the inferior to superior so as to obliterate the a dead space pouch which has formed inferiorly. So always I start with the anchors from the inferior and go proximally. And another thing to note is the knot has to be away from the articular surface to prevent any irritation of the articular cartilage. So that is very important. This is a similar Mankart repair, but here point to note is the viewing portal is the antero superior. So here you can make out, you can see release the labrum more better, in a more better way, when this is the viewing portal, and also getting the bite and everything is much better. So this is my preferred viewing portal while doing the antero the Mankart repair, the antero superior portal. The shuttling portal is the posterior. Rest all is the same. So then next we come to the humeral bone loss, which is the heel sax. Now engaging heel sax is usually if it is more than 20% of the humeral head. And if it is seen even in external rotation, then it is supposed to be more significant. It is usually visible in internal rotation because it is posterior superior, and when you internal rotate the shoulder, it comes into view. I use the funky pizza circle method to quantify the heel sax bone loss, and it is very simple. You just superimpose the circle on it and you can find out how much is the heel sax bone loss. Remplissage is the procedure. It comes from the French term to fill. So when there is an engaging heel sax with more than 20% humeral defect, you fill the defect with the posterior capsule and the infraspinatus with an anchor. So it does two things. It basically tenodesis the two structures, the infraspinatus and the posterior capsule to the heel sax. And also it reduces the posterior laxity. And since the thing is filled up, the heel sax is filled up, it does not engage. So it adds to the stability. This is a short video of remplissage. Always while doing remplissage, you do a diagnostic round, and then I pass the anchors in the heel sax. And the threads are kept in the subacromial space. I don't tie them. This is done before the Mankart is repaired. Because if you first repair the vanguard and then do the remplissage, then the shoulder becomes so contracted that you won't get a proper view of the heel sacks. So this was a wide heel sack, so two anchors were required. And then the threads are kept parked in the subacromial space in the posterior superior area. And then once the vanguard is repaired, then I tie up the threads after going into the subacromial space. So that is remplissage. Then we come to the glenoid bone loss, that is the Latarj procedure. So if the glenoid bone defect, because there is no support anteriorly, the head topples off and you get a dislocation. In Latarj, what we do is we put in a bone piece, either the coracoid, or if the coracoid is already been used up, then the iliac crest, which is known as the Iden Hippinet procedure, and fix the bone piece with a screw, usually a 4 mm cannulated cancellous screw, and that adds to the stability of the joint. So imperative before doing a Latarj is to quantify the amount of bone loss in the glenoid. So for this 3D CT scan of both the shoulders is required, so that you can compare the amount of bone loss. And as I said, if it is more than 20%, you do the Latarj procedure. In this, basically you take out the coracoid with an osteotome and split the subscapularis and fix it at the antero-inferior part with the short head of the biceps and the coracobrachialis. And it has a fantastic results. The dislocation rate post Latarj, well done Latarj, is almost less than 1%. So this is a failed vanguard repair for which Latarj is being done. The subscapular is split. All the previous threads and hardware is removed. The humeral head is being depressed with a depressor. The coracoid has been positioned over the antero-inferior area of the glenoid. And with a special jig, the Arthrex, and they provide the special jig. Two 4 mm screws are passed. Care is taken that the screws are directed away from the articular margin to prevent any irritation. And there is no step off at the articular margin area. This is at 5 months, where the CT scan shows a good healing of the bone graft. Now we come to multidirectional instability, which is very tricky, and these patients will show instability in all directions, and some patients do have some amount of pain. They might have laxity in other joints, and the sulcus test is grossly significant, more than 3 fingers. And as I said, some patients might have a degree of apprehension in the predominant component. Examination under anesthesia will confirm the multidirectional nature of the instability. Treatment is usually non-operative. Any operative intervention usually results in very poor results and recurrence. So treatment is muscle strengthening, activity, and they are to be left alone. Now, first time dislocators are again a very special subset. For these patients, it is recommended that surgery is kept for a select group of patients in these first time dislocators, which are high functional demand patients like wrestlers or boxers. or if the MRI shows evidence of a large capsular labral tear, or if post reduction they have a recurrent instability. So these patients then would require a primary Bankart repair. So take home message is follow this simple algorithm, and we should be covering up most of the patients with the appropriate line of treatment. And whenever in doubt, first diagnose the bone loss, quantify it, and whenever in doubt, don't hesitate to do the additional procedure like latargia or ampli search. Only then we can ensure good results to all our patients. Thank you. So thank you for your kind attention. Next, Dr. Kaustubh has joined us and he'll be speaking on a very tricky topic, which is rotator cuff tears. And he does extensive number of shoulder arthroscopies, and he will guide us on how to manage rotator cuff tears. Dr. Kaustubh, you have the mic.
Thank you, Dr. Sameer. First of all, let me thank Biotech and all of you for giving me this platform. And I must congratulate Dr. Sameer Pilankar for covering such an extensive topic of instability in such a short time, with almost all the salient points absolutely well brought forward. So, a very good presentation.
Thank you, Tom.
So, can I directly start sharing my screen now, or how does it go?
Yes, please.
I think you need to stop sharing first, otherwise it's not allowing.
One second. Yeah. You are on.
I can't see the option of starting my slideshow.
We can see your screen.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm Dr. Kaustubh Durve from Mumbai. I operate at Apollo Hospitals, both Spectra and the main one, Hiranandani Powai, Fortis Mulund, and a couple of others. Today we're going to talk about rotator cuff tears, which is actually a very big topic on its own, of course. So I've also tried my best to cover the salient points in as few slides as possible. But it is a large topic, so I'm sorry, and try to bear with me if possible. So before we start understanding and treating rotator cuff tears, let us understand what is required for normal cuff function. For normal cuff function, you need healthy, strong cuff muscles, a normal capsular laxity, intact, smooth undersurface of the coracoacromial arch, a thin lubricating bursa, smooth upper surface of the cuff and tuberosities, and concentricity of the glenohumeral and humeroscapular rotation. So a lot of complex factors go into good cuff function. And whenever you treat the cuff, you have to look at all of this. And unless you restore everything, you are not going to get a good result. So quickly, biomechanics. There are two force couples you should know of. On the coronal plane, you have the cuff muscles, which overall tend to pull the humeral head downwards, or depressors of the humeral head, and the deltoid, which try to pull the humeral head upwards, or it's an elevator of the humeral head. It's not just in the coronal plane. You have to also consider in the transverse plane, you have the subscapularis anteriorly and the infraspiratus and teres minor posteriorly. So this transverse plane force couple also is a very, very important force couple to consider. Now, there are various classifications of cuff tears. The partial tears, the partial thickness tears are classified depending on whether they're articular, bursal, or interstitial, and also on the basis of size, whether they are less than 3 millimeter, 3 to 6 millimeter, or more than 6 millimeter. by and large important is whether they are less than 50% of the thickness or more than 50% of the thickness. For full thickness tears, again by the size, less than 1 centimeter, 1 to 3 centimeter, 3 to 5 centimeter, more than 5 centimeter, it gives us an idea of the size, small, medium, large, massive. Then various different authors have given classifications on stages, intact cuff, partial thickness tear, full thickness tear, only supraspinatus, full thickness tear of supra as well as part of infraspinatus, those involving supra, infra and subscapularis, and stage 4 is rotator cuff arthropathy. You don't need to remember all of these various classifications, but it's good to know how the severity progresses from partial thickness tear all the way to the other end of the spectrum where you got cuff tear arthropathy. Shape of the tear. This is one important thing to consider. Classically, we have the V-shaped tear, the L-shaped and reverse L-shaped tear, then the U-shaped tear and large retracted tear. Another way of seeing the class extent was given by Patty's classification. It is quite complex. I'm not going into details. And coming to the important and often neglected component of cuff tears, which is the subscapularis tear. It is not uncommon. I think it's about 10% or so in incidence. But LaFosse has given a very useful classification, which I think we must know. Type 1 is partial thickness tear of the upper one-third. Type 2 is complete tear of the upper one-third. Type 3 is complete tear of the upper two-third. Type 4 is complete tear of the entire tendon, but the head is still well-centered and there is not much fatty infiltration, so these are repairable tears. And type 5 is complete tear with significant fatty infiltration, which are, in short, irreparable complete tears. Now, when we are talking about cuff tears, we have to always look at the muscle. The muscle gives us a very important indication of whether these tears are repairable or irreparable. And Guttallier has given a good classification of how you quantify the muscle infiltration, fatty infiltration. Goes from grade 0 to grade 4. Grade 0 is, of course, normal. Grade 1 has some fatty streaking. Grade 3 has less than 50% fatty infiltration. Grade 2 has less than 50% fatty infiltration. Grade 3 has near about 50% fatty infiltration. And grade 4 has more than 50% fatty infiltration. Again, in short, if there is 50% or more of fatty infiltration, then these tears are likely to be irreparable. Again, I would like to make a point that do not confuse fatty infiltration for muscle atrophy. Muscle atrophy will always be present whenever you have a long-standing cuff tear, and that does not mean it is irreparable. It's fatty infiltration, where in between the muscle fibers you've got fatty streaks. That is where you understand that this tear probably is irreparable if it involves more than 50% of the muscle belly. Now, when you're looking at atrophy, this is a useful Zanetti's tangent sign. If the atrophy is a tangent drawn across the supraspinous fossa at the level of the base of the coracoid, if your muscle bulk is under the tangent, less than the area covered by the tangent, then probably the muscle atrophy is significant. But in my practice, I almost never look at the fatty atrophy. I always look at fatty infiltration. Not muscle atrophy, but the fatty infiltration. So atrophy is quite understandable because the moment there is a tear, it retracts, the mechanical retraction itself reduces the muscle bulk, and long-standing tears will obviously have atrophy because it's not being used. So atrophy is not so important. You have to look at infiltration. Clinical features, very important. You have to look at the age of the patient, whether there was trauma or it's atraumatic. In case of atraumatic, you have to look at duration of symptoms. When you assess the patient, look at the weakness of individual cuff muscles, stiffness in chronic cases, and extent of functional disability. You will be surprised with very large tears. Many patients do not have any disability at all. In imaging, don't forget x-rays. Even for cuff, look at the x-ray. Ultrasound, 50-50, you may do, you may not do. I'm not a big fan of ultrasound, honestly. But MRI scan, of course, you must do. In x-rays, these two, three very important views. Simple AP view shows you the superior migration of the head. It shows you deficient cuff function because if you remember the coronal plane force couple, if the depressors, which are the cuff, are not working well, then the deltoid is unrestricted or it's unbalanced deltoid function, which causes superior migration. A better way of looking at it is by simply doing active 30-degree abduction. If you do active 30-degree abduction, it increases the action of the deltoid and it accentuates this superior migration of the head. So if you want to look at the centralization of the head, 30-degree abduction. Scapular Y view is a very useful view to get. I feel it's a little theoretical because not many of us have the comfort of having the X-ray room close to our consulting room where you can actually go and do it. If you just write a scapular Y view, I don't think there are any good X-ray technicians, not many good X-ray technicians who can do it. But if you get a good Y view, you can see the acromial morphology. You can see if there is an anterior beaking of the acromion, like a hooked acromion or a anterior spur. You can get an axillary lateral view pretty easily. Most of our technicians can do that even without our presence. That will show us joint space, whether there's anterior posterior subluxation and the glenoid morphology in arthritis, whether there's glenoid wear, particularly if there is cuff tear arthropathy or arthritis. Ultrasonography, as I said, it allows dynamic valuation. It is less expensive, but it's very operator dependent. It is limited. It does not very useful in most situations, according to me. MRI is very useful. It's got high sensitivity and specificity for the cuff tear. You can see the cuff tear here. If you look at T1 images, they actually give you more detailed information, but T2 images are easier to interpret. So T2 images show you the tear very easily. But if you look at T1, it gives you more detailed information about the extent of the tear. Because in T2, sometimes you may confuse a tendinosus high signal for a tear. In T1, the tear is seen much more clearly. More than the tear, you're looking at the other things. You're looking at tendon length. You're looking at tendon quality, level to which it is retracted, and you're looking at the muscle belly, whether there's atrophy or whether there's fatty infiltration, which is seen best on the T1 oblique sagittal cuts. We've already spoken about the Guttalia classification, so you have to know that and apply that when you see your MRIs. Before we go to treatment of these cuff tears, let's see what's happening, what would happen if you don't treat them. In short, a little history of a cuff tear. We know that there is increased prevalence of cuff tears with increasing age. We also know that large proportion of cuff tears are asymptomatic. So, what is the natural history? Where does a cuff tear start? A cuff tear typically initiates about 15 millimeter posterior to biceps tendon in the sagittal plane, and then it extends both anteriorly and posteriorly. This is the region which corresponds to what is called as the rotator crescent, or it is nothing but the area under the rotator cable, which Burkhardt has described. If you look at the muscles which it involves, we feel that it starts in the supraspinatus and then involves the infraspinatus later. But this area of rotator crescent under the rotator cable actually involves the posterior fibers of the supraspinatus and also some anterior fibers of the infraspinatus. Now, when this tear propagates to involve the anterior cable, that is when it is quickly associated with fatty infiltration and it quickly becomes irreparable with lower healing rates. So, that is a red flag for you. If the anterior cable is involved, then you must repair it quickly. Larger symptomatic tears, more than 175 square centimeters to quantify, are associated with proximal migration of humeral head. So, unless the tear becomes large, you will not see the proximal migration. So, X-rays changes are actually very late. You must do MRI scans. About 50% of tears significantly increase in size over a couple of years. And there are a number of studies to prove this. Full thickness tears, age more than 60 years. These are the two risk factors for tear progression. Increase in tear is associated with increasing symptoms also. Now, once we know the natural history, let's look at the cuff repair, the treatment part which we are so interested in. When you see a patient with a cuff tear, you must be able to divide this patient into one of three groups. So he'll either belong to group 1, group 2, or group 3. Now, what are these groups? This is a slightly important slide, so I would just recommend that the delegates look at this. Group 1 is early surgical repair. Here is where you repair the tear without waiting for anything. Group 2 Group 2 is where you give trial conservative treatment and surgical repair only if the symptoms don't resolve within a reasonable period of time, which in my books is 6 to 12 weeks. Group 3 is where you should be extremely reluctant to offer surgery to maximize conservative care, a lot of physiotherapy, anti-inflammatories as much as possible, maybe even joint injections for pain relief. And surgery should be only as a last resort if there are severe symptoms persisting after many months. So let's see, who are the group one? Group one are the people who have acute traumatic full thickness tear with good tissue quality and no muscle atrophy or no fatty infiltration. So in short, if you have a traumatic incident, the patient was doing everything before the trauma and after the trauma, suddenly his arm is not lifting. These are the patients where you do not wait for any conservative treatment. Tell them clearly, this is like a fracture. An important thing has broken and that important thing has to be repaired. It will not heal without repair. You have to go and do the surgery immediately. Second, strangely enough, subscapularis tears warrant early surgical treatment. So whether they are traumatic or atraumatic, if you see a subscapularis tear, particularly if it is associated with biceps tendon instability, then you must offer surgery, no role of conservative trial. Third, degenerative full thickness tears in younger active individuals. So there's no history of trauma. The tear is degenerative slowly, it's happened slowly, but the patient is younger. Younger in my books is below 65 years and he's active, because these are the patients where the risk of tear enlargement and reduced healing rates over time is more. Group two is fair conservative trial. Now these are partial thickness tears, particularly articular site tears, which are more amenable to conservative treatment than bursal thickness partial thickness tears. Some full thickness degenerative tears in less active older patients, you can go for conservative trial, but the patient must be made aware about the risk of tear progression. We know that 50% of the tears progress over time, and if you wait too long, there will be irreversible muscle changes. If you keep going, keep doing conservative treatment for a long time, you have to tell that to the patient. And if the patient then decides to go for conservative trial, then you can do a conservative trial for a fair amount of time, 6 weeks, 8 weeks, maximum 12 weeks. After 12 weeks, if the patient is not relieved, I would tell the patient clearly that this needs surgery. Don't wait any further. Group three is where you are reluctant to offer surgery. These are patients where many times conservative treatment, if given for a long duration, will resolve the symptoms. Which are these? These are massive irreparable cuff tears. Often they present without much disability anyway. So you can keep giving conservative treatment, strengthening the surrounding muscles, whatever remaining cuff muscles are there, you strengthen them, strengthen the deltoid, and slowly get a patient to compensate for the loss of cuff muscles. These are old patients, usually they compensate and they get good function. And very elderly patients where the tissue quality is not good, maybe they are not even fit for doing surgery under general anesthesia. So you can maximize conservative treatment. What do you do in conservative treatment? It's in four phases. Phase one is pain control, anti-inflammatory medicines, augmentation, activity modification. Phase two is stretching. You must have good range of motion. So stretch the capsule which is stiff. Phase three is strengthening the remaining intact cuff muscles, scapular stabilizers. So you first start gravity eliminated, then assisted, then anti-gravity, then free weights, then therabands. Phase four is maintenance and prevention. This is very important. Many patients get better, then they stop doing physiotherapy, then symptoms come back again, you have to start from the beginning. So you have to have lifelong exercises at least 2 to 3 times a week, continue activity restriction to protect the cuff from additional injury. Finally, coming to what we love, arthroscopic cuff repair. Now, when you do arthroscopic cuff repair, keep in mind a couple of things. Always address concomitant intraarticular adhesions. We spoke about biceps tendon pathology, which are very common with cuff tears. better visualization of the tear configuration in arthroscopy. Precise release of adhesions for tendon mobilization is possible with arthroscopy. No injury to deltoid muscle and origin of deltoid muscle. This is a very big advantage of arthroscopy. Like any minimally invasive surgery, the pain is less and the recovery is faster. So this is the reason, as far as possible, you should try to do arthroscopic cuff repair. It is not compulsory, but if you can do it, it's better. You can do either single row or double row. It's not compulsory that you must do a double row repair. It depends on what the pathology is like. It depends on the tendon length. It depends on the level of retraction and how much you can mobilize it. Double row is, of course, biomechanically superior in strength, but clinical results are equivalent. So do not get completely sold out by this double row. Don't think that every time you have to put the lateral row anchors, it is not required at all. You look at the pathology and apply basic principles, good reduction and adequate fixation. If you have any doubt about the fixation, go a little slow on the rehabilitation. But don't think that by doing double row, it's like a panacea for all your problems and then you can immediately start moving. That is not true. What are the principles of arthroscopic cuff repair? Hypotensive anesthesia, interscalene block. This is very important. Without this, it's very difficult to do. The posterior portal should be slightly more lateral and more superior compared to your intra-articular, when you're doing it for intra-articular work, like Bankart's repair. Always start with a glenoid arthroscopy. So these portals are very mobile. You can do a skin incision where you want it for the cuff repair, but you can just move the skin incision more medially and inferiorly before you enter the joint. Quickly do a glenoid arthroscopy. The important thing which you have to assess in the glenoid arthroscopy is the biceps tendon. Make sure the biceps tendon is healthy. Make sure it is not unstable. Make sure it is not frayed. And then you can decide whether you want to do something for the biceps tendon or not. Subscapularis tear, particularly the Lafosse type 1, 2, and 3 can very easily be done through the articular, through the glenoid arthroscopy, I mean transarticular viewing. Also, a pasta lesion can easily be repaired from inside the joint through the intraarticular arthroscopy itself. Don't forget to look at the biceps tendon, biceps tenotomy or tenodesis if it is frayed, unstable, or if there is a subscap tear. If there is a subscap tear which you are repairing, I think you should always do a biceps tendon, biceps tenotomy or tenodesis. It's quite dangerous to leave the biceps tendon intact if you're doing a subscapularis repair, because the biceps tendon will keep stressing your subscapularis repair. For the subscapularis, a few points. Anterior superior portal is very important for working. That's the most important working portal for you. It's along the level of the, it's along the fibers of the subscapularis. So it's along the subscapularis fibers. 70 degree scope is useful if you have it. Comma tissue. Comma tissue is a very useful landmark. It marks the superior lateral border of the subscapularis. And once you find it, you grab it, you can take a stitch in it and use it for traction, and then you can release the subscapularis all around. You have to release anterior, superior, and posterior to the tendon. So like a 360 degree release of the subscapularis. The most important adhesion when you're releasing a subscap tear is the adhesion to the under surface of the coracoid. It is very important. You must slowly, slowly develop this skill of being able to release the under surface of the coracoid. Because unless you release that, your subscapularis does not get mobilized. Even if you do an open subscap repair, make sure you release between the subscap and the coracoid. Otherwise, you don't get a tension-free repair. Anchors, of course, on the lesser tuberosity. Sutures are usually passed retrograde, particularly when you're doing through the joint. Talking about anchors, I always prefer to do my subscap repairs as a single row. I have never done a double row subscap repair. I have a feeling that if you do a double row subscap repair, you'll always end up over-tensioning it. I think a single row is better. Now, coming to a few points about the pasta repair. Remember that abduction improves visualization for the pasta because it takes the cuff a little bit away from your footprint. All inside repair is possible. If the tear is small, you don't need to go subacromial at all. You can insert the anchor through the anterior superior portal, shuttle the sutures with a 60 or 90 degree device, and looking through the joint itself, you can completely repair the tear. Another option is trans-tendinous repair. which will require clearing of subacromial bursa, but still most of the work is through the joint itself. When you're doing a posterior superior cuff repair, make sure you view from the posterior and lateral portals both as far as possible. Unless you are very sure that you can see the entire tear from the posterior portal, always try to view from the lateral portal also. Complete clearance of the bursa is required for adequate tear visualization. The very small crescent tears can be repaired by simple inverted matrix suture. They're like a suture bridge configuration. You don't need a medial anchor at all. Just take a bite and anchor it with a lateral anchor. Or you can do a double row technique, single middle, single lateral anchor, single middle anchor, single lateral anchor. It's very easy to do. You usually don't need any release for these small tears. When the tear is big, when it is retracted, you will need to mobilize it, you will need to release it. Now, again, for the delegates, a very important slide. Look at this. What are the things you need to release for a retracted cuff tear? Bursal-sided adhesions are usually released during the bursectomy. So if you do an extensive bursectomy, the bursal-sided adhesions are released. The adhesions between the articular side of the cuff and the superior aspect of the glenoid have to be released by the radio frequency. It's very useful to look through the lateral portal while doing this, and you can use the superior lateral portal to put in the radio frequency and release. These releases, if you see, are very, very similar to the releases which you would do for a frozen shoulder or a refractory adhesive capsulitis. So for a refractory adhesive capsulitis also, you must ideally release above the biceps tendon. So between the glenoid and the supraspinatus. So that is the first thing you release. Then you extend this capsular release. This is nothing but a capsulotomy basically. You extend the same capsular release posteriorly and anteriorly, just outside the labrum, about 1 centimeter away from the labrum. Finally, coming to this interval slide or interval release. What is this interval slide? Now you remember I told you that the subscapularis is usually tethered to the coracoid. And to release this tethering from the coracoid, you have to first release the entire rotator interval. It's not just the adhesion between the subscap and the coracoid. You also have always a contracted coracohumeral ligament, which is the same structure, the offending structure in the frozen shoulder. This structure has to be released in a large cuff tear because this contracted coracohumeral ligament, it basically contracts between the coracoid and the cuff tendon. So it will not allow the cuff tendons to reach your footprint. So you must do a complete interval release, release the coracohumeral ligament, also release on the undersurface of the coracoid between the subscapularis and the coracoid. And these releases are basically what we call as the interval slide or interval release. This is a very, very safe thing to do. But keep in mind that this is being done medially, in the medial part of the rotator interval, not laterally, not close to the biceps tendon pulley, not close to the combat tissue. In short, do not extend your release laterally such that you end up sectioning between the supraspinatus and the subscapularis. If you section the tissue between the supraspinatus and the subscapularis, which is nothing but the combat tissue, then you will find that suddenly it becomes very difficult to repair this tear. And even if you do repair this tear, that cuff will not have the kind of power required to center the humeral head. So not cause any sectioning or discontinuation of the tissue between the supraspinatus and the subscapularis. All your interval release has to be done medially at the level of the coracoid and the coracohumeral ligament. So that's why I wanted to spend a couple of minutes on this slide. Side-to-side margin convergence stitches for U-shaped and L-shaped tears make it easier. You can do either a single row or double row. We covered that depending on the tension length and the excursion. And if you are absolutely not getting the tendon to come to the footprint, always consider medialization of the footprint. Do not do any jabardasti trying to get that tendon to the footprint if it's not reaching. Just medialize the footprint. Usually, you don't need to do more than 5 to 10 millimeters of medialization. Freshen that area with a burr. Remove the articular cartilage there. Put the anchors on the new medialized footprint and just repair it. You will get a good result. So this is just an example. If you're getting bored, you can tell me. It's not very long. It's about 2.5 minutes. So this is a relatively small, I would say medium-sized posterior superior cuff tear. In this case, I am able to visualize the tear well from the posterior portal. So I'm not bothered looking from the lateral portal here. But always keep in mind, any difficulty in visualization, shift to the lateral portal. Don't have the footprint. Somebody mentioned that in the slap tear, I think Dr. Abhishek mentioned that. Whenever you repair something, make sure you freshen the footprint, otherwise it will not heal. So this is the anchor. In this case, I've used titanium anchor. More often, I use the peak anchor. I've retrieved the suture. This is a very simple suture passing device. You know, either an Expresso or a Scorpion or a Fast Pass or, you know, whatever brand you're using, depending on which company you're using. It passes the suture through the tendon. This one is not an auto capture device, so I need to retrieve from another portal and then tie it. Finally, when I tie it with a knot pusher, this is how the cuff comes and sits on the footprint. This is a simple single row repair, what I've done. So I usually pass them in a mattress suture configuration. If the cuff tendon is not long enough, if it is retracted, you can always do a Mason Allen suture configuration where the tendon comes and securely gets attached to the edge of the footprint. That is also perfectly acceptable. Don't feel that the tendon always has to cover the footprint. You cover the footprint only if the tendon is long enough and mobile enough to reach there. And after you've passed the required number of sutures, the required number of anchors, in this case, I think it was a 2-anchor repair. And I've taken 2 mattress sutures per anchor. So total 4 mattress sutures here. And at the end of the whole thing, then I've taken all of the stitches and I've tied all of the knots. Knot tying technique, of course, is very important. I just pass my Wissinger rod under the tear and make sure that it's not going into the joint, which means I've got not exactly a watertight repair, but at least it's tight enough to not allow the rod. I also rotate the head of the humerus to make sure that the cuff is concentrically rotating with it, which means that the cuff has been well repaired. Now, coming for a double row repair, if you're doing a double row repair, make sure you avoid over-tensioning. Because it's a basic principle of orthopedics. You have to reduce things. You do not over-reduce things. So make sure the tendon has come to the correct place on the footprint. That correct place for the tendon may not be the entire covering of the footprint. It may just be reaching till the edge of the footprint, and that is also okay. So the medial anchors typically are inserted at the articular margin. For this, make sure you make the portal just next to the lateral margin of the acromion. Because if your portal is a little more lateral, you will go too tangential and you will skive off onto the articular cartilage and you will damage the articular cartilage. The other thing, useful thing which I have noticed is while passing the medial anchors, if you're not getting a good angle, if you're coming too tangential, if you're not coming at a good attack angle, all you do is put a rolled towel under the axilla. If you put a rolled towel under the axilla, it lateralizes the humeral head temporarily and it allows you to get a good angle for your medial row ankles. After you pass the ankles, you can always remove the rolled towel so that the cuff can come and sit there without much tension. Because if you lateralize the head, the tension on the cuff is more. So just while passing the anchor, you pass it with a lateralized head. Then you remove the roll, the head goes back, and then you can repair the tendon back. For the medial row, the sutures are passed about 2 to 3 millimeters lateral to the musculotendinous junction. Now, this is a very, very important thing to look at. If you don't have much tendon lateral to the musculotendinous junction, then it is obvious that you cannot do a double row. Because 2 to 3 millimeters lateral to the musculotendinous junction is where your medial row sutures go. And only if you have significant length of tendon lateral to that, then only you can do a lateral row suture. Always tie the medial row sutures before inserting the lateral row sutures. Never ever become lazy and think that when I put the lateral row sutures, all of these sutures are going to get tensioned anyway. Why should I waste time tying the medial row sutures? There are 2 or 3 very good reasons for doing this. One important reason is that any of us who have put in a large number of anchors know that anchor pullout because of poor bone quality happens typically in the lateral row anchors. It usually never happens in the medial row. In the medial row, the bone quality is usually good and you have very good purchase of the anchors into the bone. So don't, if you're not tying the medial row anchors and if you're only tensioning on the lateral row anchors, your entire repair is dependent on the hold of the lateral row anchors, which is not a good thing at all because the hold of the lateral row anchors is sometimes not that good. Secondly, if for some reason you're unable to get or unable to pass the lateral row anchors, at least you have the medial row anchors which have been tied down so that single row repair has been done at least. That second row repair you may do, you may not do for whatever reason later, but always make sure you tie the medial row anchors so that you are not dependent on the lateral row anchors for your entire repair. If you have not tied the medial row and only tensioned with the lateral row, if the lateral row anchor loosens or backs out, your entire repair is going to give away. So always tie medial row sutures. Finally, coming to mini open cuff repair, I am a believer that arthroscopy is a tool to help you. It is not a master to enslave you. So don't always have to do everything arthroscopic. If you are not able to visualize a tear well, or you know, for whatever reason it's bleeding, you don't get a good feel. For posterior superior tears, it's a perfectly reasonable alternative to do a mini open deltoid splitting approach. You can directly, although I think it's not very easy to do a transosseous repair, it's technically very demanding, but you can do that to avoid the cost and complications of suture anchors. And of course, if you do a mini open special equipment of arthroscopy, special arthroscopy training, you take a deltoid splitting approach to the anterolateral rapid. You rotate the humerus so that different parts of the tear come into your view. The releases are the same. Do not forget the releases. You have to release the coracohumeral ligament and interval tissue from the coracoid. It is, of course, a little difficult to do that when you're not doing arthroscopy. But for a large tear, unless you do this release, I don't think you can get a good tension-free repair. At the same time, you have to release the capsule just outside the labrum, which means you just pass a tissue liberator under the tendon. You take a couple of tension sutures, hold it, counter, hold the tension on tendons, and under the tendons, pass the tissue liberator and cut the capsule. You may remember that these are the same releases we spoke about when we were talking about the arthroscopic repair. Once you get good excursion and a tension-free repair, for the transosseous repair, you can make a small bony trough, pass the transosseous sutures, shuttle them across the channels and tie over bone bridges in this configuration. Eventually, make sure the tuberosity is smoothened and the tendinous rapi is closed, the deltoid is closed. Most of the times for deltoid splitting incisions, I do not bother closing the deltoid. It falls back on its own. I just close the fascia over it and the subcutaneous skin. Finally, coming to these irreparable tears, unfortunately in India we see these quite commonly. If you have a patient with a large, massive, neglected irreparable tear with significant disability and pain, these are the patients you need to treat. Of course, after giving a very, very long conservative trial of at least 3 months, if they're not improving, then you talk about surgery. What are your surgical options? First is a partial repair. Partial repair means, for those of us who've done a lot of these, we'll realize that often the infraspinatus is repairable and supraspinatus is not repairable, which means the posterior part of the tear is repairable and the superior part of the tear is not repairable. This is because if you look at the natural history, the tear has started in the superior portion and then extended into the posterior portion. So the superior part of the tear is more long-standing, posterior part of the tear is relatively recent. So the posterior part gets repaired, superior part doesn't get repaired. So you can very well just repair the infraspinatus. And if your subscapularis is intact, you get a reasonably good force couple. The the coronal plane force couple of deltoid versus cuff muscle gets partly restored, although you don't get the supraspinatus, but the infraspinatus and the subscapularis, which are oblique muscles, will pull down the head to a certain extent against the deltoid. More importantly, the transverse plane force couple of the subscap versus the infraspinatus gets completely restored. So you can restore the force couples to a large extent by doing a partial repair. Second, tendon transfers. Two main tendons can compensate for the posterior superior cuff, which is basically the posterior supraspinatus and infraspinatus. For these two tendons, you can compensate by using either latissimus dorsi or trapezius. Let us be very honest, both these muscle transfers are technically very demanding. They are not easy to do, and in the best of the hands, give only average results at the best. Smooth and move procedure. This is where you remove any old implants, any, if there's any titanium anchor which is impinging, you remove that, do a bursectomy, do tuberoplasty, try to make the tube, the greater tuberosity spherical, remove the bursa, try to do a bit of a release of adhesions, and just leave it, then rehab the patient, whatever best recovery they get in terms of pain relief and function, they will accept it. Finally, coming to the newest kid on the block, which is interposition grafts. Now, these are coming into vogue. There's a lot of focus on these. What overall is called a superior capsular reconstruction, SCR. For that, you can use either porcine xenografts, dermal allografts, or facial autografts. The principle is simple: to put some sort of graft between the humeral head and the acromion, so that the humeral head remains away from the acromion physically, because it is thought that the rotator cuff not only gives dynamic definition of the humeral head, but it also provides an interposition tissue, you know, the supraspinatus tendon, which is more than a centimeter thick, provides a interposition tissue between the acromion process and the humeral head, which allows it to remain concentric inside the glenoid. So if you put any of these grafts and keep the humeral head concentric, it will relieve some of the symptoms of the large rotator cuff tear. Again, I must say these are technically demanding procedures. Results are probably better than the tendon transfers, but most of the results have come from the designers of the surgery themselves. So we have to wait for large-scale results from multiple centers to come out before we start doing these routinely, but these options are there. Finally, coming to the end stage of rotator cuff disorders or rotator cuff tears. This is the cuff tear arthropathy. Here, not only is the cuff tear completely irreparable, but the shoulder joint or the glenohumeral joint itself has become arthritic, which means the articular cartilage of the shoulder joint is completely worn off, and you have this kind of a picture. This is one of my patients where I did a reverse shoulder replacement. Once you have an arthropathy or an arthritis, you have to do some sort of a arthroplasty or replacement. This is an example of the of a reverse shoulder replacement. And this is, I think, actually the same patient as you saw on the... Okay, so she is not able to lift at all before the surgery. She is just an OT here. And after the surgery, see what happens. Okay, I'm not saying that it's become normal. Okay, let the video play. Let's pause it first. I'm not saying that it becomes the normal shoulder, because these are salvage operations, but it is good enough for her to do her hair. For an old lady like this, it is much better than what it was before. And most importantly, her pain is gone and she can sleep at night because the shoulder pain is not there. So don't get scared to offer reverse shoulder replacement to these patients with large cuff tear arthropathy. In fact, large rotator cuff tears, which are surely irreparable and which have significant symptoms, rather than offering experimental procedures like, I shouldn't say experimental, but low volume procedures like a tendon transfer or a SCR, I would probably be more comfortable offering a reverse shoulder replacement straight away, even if there is not much arthritis. I thank you very much for your attention, and I again apologize for the long talk. It was a long, the topic was long, so sorry about that.
Yeah, Kausup, though it was long, you made it very interesting.
And most importantly, you covered everything in all possible details and also gave us valuable inputs about which particular procedure to choose for in a particular rotator cuff injury. So that covers the entire talk. Now, there are a few questions from the delegates. One question is to all of us, what is the rehab protocol? We'll start with you since you are already there. What is your rehab protocol for a regular single row rotator cuff repair?
Okay, for actually rather than single row or double row, I categorize my rotator cuff repairs as small tear, medium tear or large tear, or rather small tear and large tear. I don't try to complicate it too much. In small tear, I mean tension-free repair. And in large tear, I mean repair probably under a little bit of tension, not too much tension. So for a small tear, I keep them in a sling for 2 to 6 weeks, depending on the size of the tear and depending on the healing potential of the patient. At 2 weeks, I usually start completely passive assisted elevation and abduction and gravity elimination, gravity eliminated abduction in supine position. These are exercises which the patient can do on their own. Because at such an early stage, I do not want to hand them over to any physiotherapist. So these are simple exercises which I teach the patient themselves. By 4 to 6 weeks, depending on the size of the tear, I then hand them over to the physiotherapist. If they have done their passive movements well, the stiffness is not much, but the physiotherapist obviously has to stretch out a little bit. Any operated shoulder becomes a little stiff, as all of us know. And once they get their passive range of motion, I focus a lot on passive. In cuff tears, I don't think it's a surgery where you have to be aggressive in strengthening at all. Once they are comfortably able to do passive, then side by side, I move on to active assisted, where there is still somebody supporting the hand while they are elevating it. For 3 months, I do not allow any active elevation or abduction at all, even for the small tension-free tears, mind you. After 3 months, I then allow them to do anti-gravity exercises up to 6 months. After 6 months, for a very, very few younger, very active, very motivated patients, I may allow a little bit of resistance, starting with 0.5 kg free weights in the hand, then moving on to 1 kg free weights if they are able to do. I do not like TheraBands at all because I personally don't know what TheraBands give, what kind of resistance. But I'm very happy with telling them 0.5 kg free weight, full 1 kg free weight at the most. So in short, what I'm trying to tell you is I'm very, very slow with these cuff tears. Anybody else wants to put in their
Yeah, work? I would agree because rotator cuffs are notorious for re-tear. And you need to tiptoe the around the rehab protocol. Now, Dr. Abhishek, what is your post-op protocol for your slap repairs?
So, for the slap repairs, I think we should understand the problem is happens only if you are doing overhead activities. And most of the time, it is the scapular muscles and upper back muscles that are weak. So, you initially start with gentle rotation exercises, avoid all overhead activities, and you start building up. And the main aim is to centralize the humeral head into the glenoid. So, you start building up the scapular muscles and the upper back muscles and to offload it. And gradually, after 6 weeks, we can start the... And the other thing that you have to do is there's a lot of times there's internal rotation deficits. So what I had shown there. So you have to start the rotations, maintain the passive range, wait for 6 weeks to 8 weeks, and then you gradually start the active exercises.
Dr. Abhishek, could you immobilize the shoulder post slap tear? And if you immobilize for how long?
I immobilize it, but it is not a, it's not a complete immobilization. Because then the shoulder gets very stiff. So around 10 to 15 degrees movements, with the patient or the relative holding the hand so that the shoulder doesn't get stiff. That is what I tell them. They can do it on their own in at home till around 4 to 6.
part of the other subgroup of patients with larger cuff tears, I actually put them in an abduction brace, very close to 90 degrees, at least 70 degrees, for as long as 6 weeks. And after 6 weeks, and then I start the same rehab protocol after that. Sorry. Yeah.
For band cuts, I usually immobilize them in an aeroplane splint at 30 degrees. And at 4 weeks, till 4 weeks, just passive range within 15-20 degrees. And at 4 weeks, I would start aggressive mobilization. Aggressive in the sense, again, aggressive as per the patient's pain. If there is pain, then of course you go one step back. I avoid external rotation till about 2 months. Extreme external rotations till 2 months. Dr. Abhishek and Dr.
Just one question on your bankards. Mm-hmm. Do you routinely use a physiotherapist service for your bankards?
I usually don't. Most of the patients are able to mobilize their shoulders adequately on their own. Very few resistant patients, they might require to go to a physiotherapist. Usually, I am a bit wary of sending my patients, any patients.
It's more about restricting.
So obviously, you need to send because you need a lot of patients with the mobilization. But shoulders, I'm a bit wary of sending to physiotherapists. So that's how it is. Another question from the audience, the delegates, is suppose at a point of rehab, you get pain. How do you tackle it? Significant pain. Dr. Kausup, you can start.
So if there's significant pain in the middle of rehab, you have to actually evaluate the patient. Make sure that nothing has happened, first of all. You know, you have to always rule out the dangerous possibilities. Has some of your repair given way? Or if there's increasing, persistent, continuous pain, always keep in mind infection. Although these are arthroscopic surgeries, infection rates are very low. But these are implant surgeries, so pain, always rule out infection. Once that's ruled out, it's simple. Just roll back your physiotherapy to the stage where they were comfortable. Keep it there for at least 2 to 3 weeks. And then once the pain settles, you can restart. I love anti-inflammatory medicines. I use the selective COX-2 ones like Lornoxicam or Etoricoxib or something. And you can always give intermittent courses of anti-inflammatory medicines for most patients, unless there's gross contraindication like existing renal disease or something like that.
Yes, Dr. Abhishek. What is your take on it?
So you need to actually evaluate and find out what is the reason for pain, whether the patient has been pushed too much for exercises, whether it started when it's forceful range exercises are done, or it is a specific activity that is causing the pain. So once you know what you are dealing with it with, then you basically step down a little bit. So if there's pain, you know that there's some problem that is going on. So don't push the patient hard and damage it further. Tell to modify the kind of protocol, or you can go a little slower than what you are supposed to do. And of course, as Kasubs have said now, it can be infection or it can be a damage to whatever things you have to done. So you really have to rule that out before taking any decision. But if there is pain, I absolutely tell that you should not push more because you can damage further.
That's right. That is also my take on it. Basically, if there is pain and significant pain, which is not remitting even with rest, then I would go back to the drawing board and find out what is causing the pain. And I would not hesitate to do an MRI also if the pain just continues. So that's it for pain during rehab. Dr. Amit, there is one question from the delegates. You are a budding arthroscopist, and now you are doing shoulder also quite regularly. So, what is your advice to this new breed of orthopedic surgeons who want to foray into arthroscopy?
Sir, it's a long learning curve, and I would definitely ask them to buddy along with a senior surgeon like you or Kaustubh sir. And definitely just at least observe them for 6 to 8 months before venturing into it. And obviously have somebody by your side as a reliable surgeon while you're doing your initial surgeries. So they can always be there, and definitely you can go on your own in a few years or something. Maybe after a year or something, you can start on your own.
Right. That's true.
One more simple thing. Don't just aim to open at any point. It's as simple as that. If you know that you can do it open, if your arthroscopy is not working, then
We did it open only, sir. We were not successful in our initial surgeries. We used to do open only. When I used to do it.
Yeah, till very recently, open rotator cuff repair was the gold standard in rotator cuff surgery. Now, with the advances, you can do a better job arthroscopically. But still, a few years back, open rotator cuff repair was the gold standard. So, it is not that you lose any face by opening up the patient. As long as the patient is happy at the end, that should be your goal. Right, so I think it was a very educational talk from everyone, and I learned from your talks, and I hope my talk was also informative and interesting. And if there are no questions from the audience, I think we can wind up the talk.
Can I just make one point/question about what we spoke earlier? A slab repair with Bankarts. I know Dr. Abhishek has given the answer very nicely, but just one small point I wanted to make is that if your Bankarts is extending superiorly close to the attachment of your long head of biceps, I would be a little wary about repairing that, because the anterior portion of the attachment of long head of biceps can be left detached without any real functional deficit. It's mainly the posterior part of the labrum from where if you read the papers, the fibers of the long head of biceps are continuous. I think some 80% or something of them are continuous with the posterior, not with the anterior labrum. So if the posterior labrum has been detached with a Bankarts, then you may actually be dealing with something like a global tear, like a multi-direction instability, where there may be a posterior inferior labral tear also, which will need additional portals and additional anchors to deal with that. But just because the anterior inferior tear is extending a little superiorly than normal, please don't go and repair that, because you know about the normal sublabral recess. It may actually be normal, or even if it is not normal, if in that region of the rotator interval, if the labrum is not attached to the glenoid, it will not cause any instability or any symptom at all, in my opinion. So that's just one small point, sir.
That's a very good point. Right. So I think that covers up everything. Khyati, you want to add something? Closing remarks?
You're on mute.
Spellbounded by the talks. Anyways, I will do the honors. It's fantastic having this talk. I think we should do it again sometime soon. And we might have the same panel.
Thank you. Amir. Thank you, everyone. Sir. Thank you. So it was great learning experience.
Biotech and the delegates for making it a good grand success. Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much,
all, for your participation and time.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Great. Thanks. Okay, signing out.
Yeah. Yes. Bye, sir. Bye,
Kostas. Yeah, ending this webinar now.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Bye. Sir, thank you so much, sir. Bye, sir.